Hey everybody, welcome to part two of the Collective Archives, where I take lots and lots of my old notes that I haven't had time to make full videos on, and I just take you through those notes and give you some basic ideas on various subjects. So today, I've taken from my archives about 16 different topics here. We've got one book among them, which we'll be going into shortly, and tons of other notes. Right. Okay, and I've got other notes on the screen here in support of what's here. Okay, so the first one on the list today is what I've called science fiction versus future fiction. What we call science fiction, any movies that are set in the future are usually called science fiction. And it's interesting that the idea seems to be underpinning that, which is the future is all about science, but it's not. I mean, if you go and look at a lot of old classic science fiction movies, well, not just classic ones, but ones that were terrible as well, and you look at them from decades ago or even like 50, 60 years ago, and you look at how they thought in the past that the future was going to be, and very often, most of the time, it turns out that what those old science fiction movies predicted didn't come about, the vast majority of it. I mean, we've got the internet, which hardly any science fiction predicted at all. We've got mobile phones, which are kind of like, I suppose you could equate them as being a little bit similar to the tricorders, whatever it was that they carried in Star Trek, where they could talk to each other, like mobile phones. But we haven't got like Beam Me Up Scotty yet. We haven't got like flying cars, which we had in Blade Runner. It said at the start of the film, the movie was set in 2019, and there's all kinds of technology and genetic advancements in the Blade Runner movie which haven't happened in real life. Now, what I've been looking for, and I can find very little of whatsoever, is movies that are set in the future but do not involve big changes in society being created by technology or by science. I mean, we could arguably look at the future and say that, you know, in 10, 20 years' time, the world probably won't look much different to the way it is now. We'll probably be still driving cars the way we do now. We'll probably still be living in the same types of houses made out of bricks and mortar or wood, depending on where you're from. The world isn't really going to look that much different. There will be some fashion differences, probably. That's something that changes a lot. From decade to decade, you know, people from the 1950s dressed very, very differently to people of the 1970s, and people in the 1970s dressed differently to how they do now. So what I'm interested to see, I guess we could call it a new genre I would like to see, and there must be some examples of it out there, but I can't think of any. I would like to see some future fiction instead of science fiction. Movies that are set in the future where the changes in society are more social, because people's habits change a lot from decade to decade. What is acceptable one decade is not acceptable the next, and so on. And so to me, the future is far more interesting in terms of how people's attitudes will change, in terms of how social structures will change, power structures will change, and all that kind of stuff. So I would like to see a lot more movies about that. There was one example that sprung to mind that had a little bit of this, which was a movie called Runaway, which starred Tom Selleck, and I think it was made in 1982 or 1984. And in this movie, a villain uses these very sort of crude programmed robots to kill people, and in that movie people have also got robots in the houses to clean up and cook and stuff like that. Now that stuff is science fiction. It still hasn't happened, and we're still nowhere near it. The idea of having a butler or a maid in your house who is actually an android, nowhere near it. You know, I don't see it even happening in the next 20-30 years, to be honest. But one thing that movie Runaway did have is that, aside from the robots being in people's houses, the world looked the same. Same old cars, same old houses, same old outfits. If you took the robots out of the movie, you wouldn't really realise that it was set in the future. So yeah, that's it's just a genre that I would like to see come about. You know, future fiction, where technology and science are not the main focus of humanity's future. I'm just going through some more of my notes on this. Some of this stuff is not written in a very grammatical way, it's just scribbled notes. Reality has been internet technology, mobile phones, video games, but we're still using flat screens. You know, all these science fiction things where we have holograms, 3D holograms, you can walk into a room and you can walk through the hologram. Nope, still not happening. No space colonization, I've talked about that before. No household androids, no self-motivated artificial intelligence, and no household robots. Yeah, I've already mentioned a couple of those things. Some other changes that have happened, which I suppose some of these were predicted in some of the old science fiction movies and books, is political changes, cultural changes, changes in how news and entertainment media occur. Drugs, different types of drugs from one generation to the next being used, fashion styles, already mentioned that. Changes to the family structure. So yeah, you know, any of you who are writers out there, have a think about this. Maybe think about writing some stuff about the future in which the world isn't much different technologically, but the social changes are really different. It could be a fascinating genre if this was done, because in the same way that we have historical films where the thing that is of most interest is not necessarily that they didn't have technology. What is most interesting about the past, well, at least to me anyway, is how people behaved and thought differently in the past, had different values, different customs, different beliefs. And, you know, we can sort of project into the future and do that in a fiction format. Next, a very, very small thing I wanted to tell you people about. I haven't got any special insights into this, but it's something that I've found very helpful in my life the last few months. A lot of people are getting into this cold resistance training where, you know, you start off by having very, very cold showers and you just stay under for 15, 30 seconds to begin with, because it's all most people can initially handle, or at least it's all they think they can handle. And then over time, you gradually build up the amount of time that you spend having a cold shower. And the basic idea is that the cold shower, the coldness basically boosts your immune system. And it, I think it opens your what do you call them, capillaries, veins, whatever. And basically, it trains your body to be more self-sufficient in terms of heating itself. And I saw some of the Wim Hof documentaries, that guy who does all these, is it like this old guy who does all these marathons running in the freezing cold with just a pair of shorts and shoes on, and he swims in freezing cold water, and I think he holds all kinds of world records for cold resistance. And I thought I'd give it a go. And yeah, it took me about maybe 4 or 5 cold showers, and I was able to go from, at first I was only able to spend 10 or 15 seconds under the cold shower and I would be like jumping out shivering. And by about the fifth time I was able to stay under for probably about 5 minutes. And I was amazed how rapidly my body learned to resist the cold. And I think the longest I've stayed under is about 15 minutes. I could have done longer, except that I just get bored being in a cold shower. So I generally just do 5 to 10 minutes now. And yeah, my cold resistance has really improved a lot. I mean, I've been doing this for quite a few months. I know it's summer here at the moment. It's been quite warm. But when we were in spring, and we didn't have a very warm spring here in Britain this year, we had some actually really quite cold days. And I was finding it on those days, I was able to just go out and about and do my thing, just wearing a t-shirt. And whereas previously I would have been taking a sweater or a coat or something, especially if it was windy. And I was finding I could go out on a cold, windy day and just a t-shirt and hardly feel it. I'd touch my skin and I would feel that my skin was cold. And yeah, I was like, wow, all my life I've had this thing where I've been quite sensitive to the cold, and just one week of having cold showers every, maybe not every single day, but I probably had cold shower 2 days out of 3. And within a week, my cold resistance had fired up. And by the end of the second or third week, it shot up a lot more. And A really good test of this I did was when I went to the beach a few weeks ago, and I used to be one of those people who, even on a hot day, the ocean water's pretty cold. And, you know, when you're walking out there and you can feel it creeping up your legs and it's like, oh, my legs are getting freezing cold. And, you know, you get up to, you know, the top of your legs and it's like, oh, my God, this is really cold. And some people find that they can't go any further. And sometimes I was like that. I just could not go into freezing cold water at the beach. I could do it up to my knees and then I'd just be shivering. Not this time. This time I went to the beach and I went straight out. I think I got up to about my waist in the cold water, and I thought, well, it's going to take me ages to walk out further. So I just dipped down, straight under, cold water up to the neck. I've never been able to do that in my whole life, and I just did it straight away the last time I went to the beach. And yeah, so I'm hoping that this winter, especially with gas bills going up, I'll be saving a lot of money on heating the house because I'm not going to feel the cold so much. So yeah, I mean, if you guys haven't heard of this, I'm sure most people seem to have heard of it now, and I've got a few friends who have been doing this cold shower thing. I highly recommend it. My way of doing it was initially, because I know some people have had trouble trying to get themselves into this cold shower thing. My way of doing it initially was like I would just get the cold, have the cold shower running on one part of my body, like maybe just my arm and my shoulder, and just keep my arm and my shoulder under there for about 30 seconds. And that way you wouldn't be shivering so much, but that arm would be dealing with the cold, and then you do the other arm. And yeah, I was just doing like different body parts first before I would then step in and have like the full cold water all over me. So yeah, highly recommend doing the cold showers technique to boost your immune system and boost your cold immunity. And I'm sure there's a whole bunch of other health benefits, but I haven't really looked into it. I have been feeling healthier since I did the cold showers, and I now crave it. You know, if I get a shower, my body demands the cold water. I'll be under the warm shower, and my body's like, no, don't want this warm. I want the cold water, the cold shower. It feels better, and it wakes you up. It's great. Yeah, so that's it, cold showers. Okay, next up, we've got this thing about the James Bond movies. Okay, now I had this written down initially as James Bond, Death and Promiscuity. And I also had, I had it in mind to do a video on this titled something like James Bond is a Serial Killer. Now, I've got a load of notes here on it. Yeah, so basically the idea is that James Bond is a serial killer because in virtually all of the James Bond movies, he starts off single at the beginning of the movie, and he'll have sex with usually at least two women throughout the story. I don't know if that's still the case in the Daniel Craig Bond films, because they're probably trying to be more politically correct, so they have him bang less women as if that's somehow more noble. But basically, the idea I had about this is that there's a fantasy element of discarding lovers in James Bond. So in real life, if you're going to have lots of sexual partners and, you know, a brief involvement with each one of them, you have the thing of like, you know, you start a little bit of a relationship, a bit of involvement, and you sleep with them once or twice. And then you have to get rid of them. You have to say to them, I don't want a relationship, or I don't want any further involvement. And you have to deal with the guilt that you basically misled them into thinking they would get in a relationship. And the way the James Bond movies deal with the dumping the girl guilt is quite interesting. So typically, there'll be some really attractive woman who is not the central Bond girl of the film, but she's an attractive secondary character, and Bond will have some involvement with her. He will sleep with her, and then she will get killed, right? So then Bond is free to go on after the woman he really wants, who is the central Bond girl of the story. So he gets to have this fling with this usually gorgeous secondary Bond girl. There might be a couple of them in the same movie. I'm not sure what the record is for Bond sleeping with girls in a single movie. I'm sure there's been Bond films where he slept with maybe four or five women in one movie, some of the older Bond movies. So basically, Bond gets the girl he wants, but he doesn't want her long-term. He has sex with her, and she gets killed, or something else happens that makes her disappear. And then Bond is free, and he didn't have to dump her. She got killed, so he's guilt-free. And then he can go after the next Bond girl. And he'll move through the ranks of Bond girls in that movie until he gets the one who he really wants, who is the goddess of the film. and a lot of the time, there are situations where it almost seems like Bond wants the girls he sleeps with to get killed so that he can be rid of them. Sometimes the girl will be involved with the enemy. The villain of the story, it'll be one of his girls who works for him, and Bond will sleep with her. The villain finds out he has her killed. I know that definitely happened in Moonraker, and I think it's happened with quite a few others, to be honest. And that's part of the psychology, is I think Bond sleeping with the enemy's employed women is kind of like a way of saying to the villain, look, it's almost like saying, I banged your girlfriend, I banged your wife. That's part of the fantasy. But it also happens in between the Bond films as well. At the end of each Bond film, he usually hooks up with a particular girl, a very attractive girl. And the impression that's given is that, you know, they've been through a lot of trauma together. They fought the enemy, and there's a real trust between Bond and this girl now, and they have bonded. and then the film ends with him kissing her, and the music kicks in, and it's like, oh, they live happily ever after. And then the next Bond movie comes along and that girl has disappeared. She's just gone. And what happened in between? did he dump her? You know, have some scenes been omitted where Bond basically says to the girl, look, I know we had a lot of fun. I know we fought this villain and we did a lot of stuff. But hey, you know, I'm James Bond. I get to bang lots of women. I'm not going to just give myself to you for the rest of my life. And I'm bored in this relationship and I want out. Imagine if you had a scene at the beginning of each Bond film where he did that to the girl who he got with in the last movie. Imagine how rapidly audiences would lose respect for James Bond. But yeah, the girl just disappears. So does he dump her? And I thought it would be really fun sort of conspiracy video to do with a theory that James Bond is a serial killer. So he gets the mega babe at the end of each film, and then before the next movie begins, he kills her, you know, and he's got like a sort of John Wayne Gacy type situation where he's got all the women's bodies buried in some location. just thought it was a really funny idea. Let me just look through my notes here, see if there's any other thoughts I had on it. Does he deliberately put women in danger who he's banged so that they will get killed? Examples here. In Moonraker, the girl who's a helicopter pilot who works for the villain, Bond basically sleeps with her and she gets killed by the villain. Bond should have saw that coming and saved her, but he didn't. Live and Let Die, there's a black girl who he sleeps with and she's working for the enemy as well. So he sleeps with her, and then he, if I remember rightly, he challenges her and he basically says to her, I know you're working for the enemy. And he's got a gun pointed at her and she runs away. And he's like, oh, don't run away. You don't need to run away. Like, he's really concerned for her. And then she gets shot and she dies. So that's two examples. I've wrote here, James Bond as a vampire, because he basically has this ability to hypnotize women. In some of the Bond movies, all he has to do is walk into a room and women just like, oh, they just stare. It's almost like, you know, the Greek mythology, the sirens, and they would sing beautifully, and the pirates would go crazy trying to get to the amazingly gorgeous girl. They'd be hypnotized, basically, and they'd jump off the ship and they'd drown. Well, I have to kind of think of James Bond as being a sort of a male version of that. Wherever he goes, women are just drawn to him, hypnotized by him, you know, as if he's a vampire or a siren. And they get themselves killed in the process of trying to have Bond just for one night. Another one here, yeah. Bond often sleeps with women knowing that they are only after information or are trying to kill him. Yeah. I think Never Say Never Again, that happened. I think one of the girls he sleeps with kept trying to kill him. But yeah, loads of these situations where Bond will, it's almost like he will let himself be taken in by a girl who works for the villain. And he knows that she's trying to get him killed, she's trying to get information and so on. And he will put himself in great danger just to sleep with her. And he knows he's putting himself in great danger. He does it anyway. You know, it's like he can't keep his cock in his pants, you know. I've got here types of sex partner disposal. The sex partner will be killed by the villain, and it also helps justify Bond's anger toward the villain, but he actually wanted the girl out the way anyway. Or sometimes Bond simply abandons the girl and we don't get to see her again. In the Moonraker film, there's a girl he sleeps with who, when he goes to Rio, and there's a girl who's like an agent, an inexperienced agent, who is assigned to help him find his way round to various places in Rio. He sleeps with her within about 2 minutes of meeting her. and then she just disappears from the story. I think she gets attacked by Jaws and he saves her. And then he just tells her to go and get some rest in a hotel room or something. And that's it. She's out the story then. Another type of sex partner disposal is that the woman herself is disinterested in a relationship. Yeah, I guess that would often happen with the villains, the ones who work for the villain. Or the girl he sleeps with sacrifices herself to save him. I'm sure I've seen that in a few Bond films, but I can't remember which ones. Or occasionally, Bond will actually kill the girl he slept with in self-defense. Again, never say never again. The villainess in that one was really good. And he slept with her. And I think he shoots her with a pen in the stomach. It's got an exploding bullet and she blows up. yeah, and going back to that thing about the Bond girls who sacrificed themselves to save him. Again, that's like the sirens. Like he's a male siren with a sort of hypnotic thing. They worship him so much they'll sacrifice their life to save him. In fact, that happened in The Spy Who Loved Me. There was a girl who works for the enemy. She meets him for about maybe 1 minute at most of screen time. And she knows that a guy is going to shoot James Bond, but she's only just kissed him, lasting about 5 seconds. She's already fallen for him. And she actually positions herself so that she gets shot. She sacrifices her life for James Bond, who she only met less than a minute before. Pure fantasy. Bond banging the villain's wife, or the equivalent of a wife, yeah, happens a lot. And this is interesting. On Her Majesty's Secret Service, the George Lazenby Bond film, which some people love, some people hate. Personally, I quite like it. And I thought he was okay as Bond. In fact, I thought he was pretty decent. In that film, Bond gets married and his wife gets killed. There's an interesting bit of psychology to that. A lot of people say, oh, it's a darker Bond film because his wife gets his heart broken, blah, 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 blah. But his wife getting killed, not only does that justify him looking for a new sexual partners in the next movie, but it also, it justifies his general lack of commitment. And I think there are other times in one or two of the other Bond movies, this actually happened in Octopussy, where a woman asks him about his marital status or his relationship status, and he says, oh, I was married once, so I'd rather not talk about it. It's Roger Moore playing him this time. And he's basically referring back to On Her Majesty's Secret Service. So I guess Bond, we don't see it very much in the films, but he could use the excuse again and again, oh, I was married and she got killed. Therefore, I can't commit to you in a relationship because it would be too dangerous for you being my partner. And that's a nice excuse so that he doesn't have to be in a relationship and he can just go out and bang more women. You get the occasional moment where Bond appears to sort of mature in relation to which women he sleeps with. In the another Roger Moore one. It's all the Roger Moore ones that I'm most familiar with that have stuck in my mind because I grew up with Roger Moore as Bond. In For Your Eyes Only, there's a girl who must be about 18 or something. She offers to sleep with Bond. And Roger Moore must have been late 40s, early 50s when that film was made. And he refuses to sleep with her. And she's literally there in his bed, naked, under the sheets, waiting for him and offering herself to him. And he makes a joke out of it, something like, let's go out, get your clothes on, and I'll buy you an ice cream. It's a very funny scene. And there is a moment in Moonraker as well where Bond resists women. It's the moment where he finds Drax's lair in the South American jungle, where the rockets are going to take off into space. And when he finds this lair, all of these mega hot babes show up, and it's kind of a trap. It's like a honey trap. All these gorgeous women he's surrounded by in this sort of tropical exotic type setting with gorgeous music. And the women are a trap, and Bond avoids them. And there's a bridge that he's supposed to walk over in order to make it to a door, but he refuses to cross that bridge. And it's kind of like a metaphor. He's not fallen for the honey trap. So that was an unusual moment. And in Casino Royale, actually the girl he does fall in love with, and he apparently really does fall in love with her. I didn't really see, I wasn't convinced of the basis that he falls in love with her. He fell in love with her as if he'd hardly ever slept with any women. And she dies in Casino Royale. This is the remake of Casino Royale with Daniel Craig. So he falls in love with her, and Bond is shown heartbroken, and it's all politically correct because he's not using women. But she dies at the end in order to save him, and then Bond is free, and the next movie, Quantum of Solace, to go out and chase after some more women. Condoms is a funny issue. We never hear of Bond using a condom. We never see him buying condoms. We never see a condom fall out of his wallet. He must carry quite a supply of them, unless he just doesn't bother using them, in which case, what about sexually transmitted diseases, the amount of women he sleeps with? And what about unwanted pregnancies? Because Bond never has any children. He sleeps with all these women, and yet he never seems to have an unwanted pregnancy. Maybe he kills them off. How many women does he bang in all of the movies put together? God, he must have had something like maybe 80 or 100 different women throughout all the Bond movies. That's the ones we get to see. So anyway, yeah, that's my general notes on James Bond, Death and Promiscuity, or James Bond as a serial killer, whichever way you want to take it. Now, next up... I got my girlfriend to get me this book because I'd heard about it. This book is called Nudge, and it's by Richard H. Thaler and Cass R. Sunstein. Now, I'm not familiar with Thaler's writing. I have heard his name before. Cass Sunstein, I have come across some of his material before, and he had a lot of strange ideas that I thought were kind of silly, but communicated in a typical, how would you put it? Maybe a sort of an academic manner where a lot of long-winded explanations are used to give across very basic and simple concepts. I read an article by Sunstein years ago that really cracked me up. It was a long article, and he was talking about how policymakers and governments and so on can combat conspiracy theories. So I read his article on that, and the article must have been about maybe, I think it was about nearly 100 pages long, and it was a PDF article, I think I read of it, and it could have easily been narrowed down to like 20 or 30 pages. That's how dragged out it was. But he had some really oversimplified stuff in there that was presented in a long-winded way. For example, one is that if you want to discredit a particular conspiracy theory, instead of having a government address it directly, what you do is you get third-party sources in the news media and so on to do the debunking for you. And, you know, it was a lot of people, you know, talk about the news media being in cahoots with the government, and it is true and it isn't true. It's a mixture of two. It's, you know, some people take the view that the news media is completely controlled by private interests or by the government or so on. And some people say that, no, we've got a completely free press. Well, the truth is somewhere in between that. We have a lot of people in the news media, a lot of editors who are trying to do a good job trying to get things out. But we've also got a lot of people in there who basically are just shills, who will take money from whoever is offering it in order to put out a story that is a load of garbage. There's plenty of evidence out there. But anyway, Sunstein was talking about how to combat conspiracy theories, and he was saying that one way to do it was basically to get newspapers to publish lists of ridiculous conspiracy theories, you know, really stupid ones, and take the one that you want to discredit, the one that, is catching on with the public, and you slot that one in amongst the 10 so that you make it look ridiculous by association to the other 9 conspiracy theories. So among the other 9, you would probably have stuff like lizard people running the earth and flat earth and things like that. Things that are very easy to discredit, and where the people who are presenting it are very easily to pass off as being just like, you know, lunatics, conspiracy theorists, whatever you want to call them. Stuff that makes people sound mentally ill, basically. So you take the conspiracy theory that you don't like and you want to discredit, and instead of just addressing it directly, which I think is a better way to do it, you lump it in with another 9. And that was one of the silly ideas. But the problem with this is that it's not going to work long term, because it will have a short term effect on people like that. And some people, maybe not all of us, but some people would look at a list like that and go, oh yeah, well, that conspiracy theory was lumped in with 9 stupid ones, therefore it's not true. Yeah, okay, fair enough. That will work on some people, but other people will recognize the tactic and will go, that's just bullshit. So that was the kind of impression that I got from reading Sunstein's work in the past. Now, this book, I haven't read all of it yet. There's various chapters in here. I've heard about it before, and it's called Nudge because it's all about basically nudging people into making the decisions that you want them to make. So this is a book for, as far as I can tell, policymakers, company bosses, anyone who's in any kind of public relations position and stuff like that. Let's see what kind of a description we got here. I'll read the back description for you. Nudge has transformed the way individuals, businesses and governments look at how we make choices and become one of the most important books of the 21st century. From what I've read of it so far, I think that's a massive overstatement. This completely updated edition offers a wealth of new insights for fans and newcomers alike about COVID-19, diet, personal finance, retirement savings, medical care, organ donation and climate change and so on. So I haven't read about those specific issues in the book yet, but apparently they're in there. So, Nudge. First of all, the book is titled wrong, in my opinion. I mean, I read one chapter so far, which is, I mean, I glanced through a few chapters, but the one that I properly read was chapter 3, Following the Herd. And it's all about how people follow the herd, why they follow the herd, what makes them follow the herd, and so on. And the chapter is very sneaky in how it presents its ideas. And personally, from what I've read so far, I think the book should just be called Manipulate instead of Nudge. Or maybe you could call it Push, because you're trying to push people into holding the view that you want them to have. And he does talk about political voting patterns in here as well. So he's talking about ways of manipulating people's vote, as far as I can tell. Well, I say he, but it's actually the two writers. But Sunstein's the one that I'm familiar with. And the title could be called Manipulate, Push. It could be called Mislead. You know, I think that the title itself is very dishonest. It's a sort of watered down propaganda word to hide the fact that the book is about how to manipulate people. So, I'm sure I've got some notes in here. Oh no, I didn't write much. So let me just sort of glance through this chapter. I wrote some notes in the book as I was going along. So, chapter 3, Following the Herd. What others do? Yeah, there was a reference to some other unspecified source here, and I looked at the back of the book, and it turned out that the unspecified source was just simply one of Sustine's own other publications, referencing yourself, you know. Okay, yeah, so one of the major points of this is that when a new issue is brought into the public domain, or at least in the news media is brought into the public domain, an important thing, what these guys are saying, it seems to me what they're saying is basically, you want to, if you're a PR person, what you want to do is you want to control the narrative as early as possible. As soon as the new story comes out, the new issue comes out, you've got to get out there and you've got to have a big push and get your narrative in first, right? But not only have you got to get your narrative out, but you have to persuade people that your narrative is already widely agreed with. That's basically what they're saying in this chapter. And I mean, we see that a lot. Various issues come out over the years, and you know, the news media will almost collectively, upon instinct, will go with a particular narrative. So you'll get a couple of major publications, maybe the New York Times, the Washington Post, the BBC, the Telegraph, the Guardian, whatever. It doesn't matter whether these newspapers are so-called left or right-wing, as long as they get the story out first and they set up the initial narrative, and then the rest of the news media tends to follow it automatically. Some people view that as it being the whole media is just told directly, consciously what to write. No, that's not how it works. You know, you get the major newspapers, they do it first, and then the smaller ones just follow suit because it's easy journalism to just copy the same sources. And they also use wire copy services. So hundreds of small newspapers will get the same story from a wire copy service, and that's why you get the same stories just being spread suddenly everywhere and presented in the same way. Now, what I notice particularly tends to happen, so I'm sweating here. We're having quite a hot summer here in Britain, and the last few weeks have been boiling. And I've got the windows closed here because fucking there's seagulls outside. They've been, you know, on the roofs with the baby seagulls are flipping out, calling the mothers all the time. So I've got the window closed. Anyway, slight distraction there. We do tend to get this pattern with the news media where a story will break and it will be collectively covered in almost the exact same way everywhere. An example that I already covered before was the whole Michael Jackson Leaving Neverland documentary. Well, they call it a documentary, but it was absolute garbage. I tore it to pieces in several videos. Other people tore it to pieces. But the initial narrative on that documentary was that it was true. And finally, he's been exposed. Michael Jackson has been exposed. And exposed. Sorry. Anyway, yeah, so the initial narrative was all one direction. And the initial narrative gave the impression that everybody who sees this documentary is convinced by it. And that's how quickly it catches on. And we see this with loads and loads of issues. And a lot of it, I suspect, is done with the kind of narrative control in mind that this guy talks about. Get the story out and make sure that all of your contacts and sources in the news media and so on and on social media, because there's a lot of people who operate on social media who are hired hands, hired by PR companies and so on, who basically go around online pretending that they are everyday people and they try to manipulate narratives towards whatever they're being paid to manipulate it towards. Tons of that goes on. But then, as time goes on, that narrative begins to collapse because other voices, which are initially drowned out, start to surface. People get bored of the one-dimensional narrative, and naturally, people start asking questions. Well, why am I only hearing this side of things in the media? Why am I not hearing this question asked? Why is this piece of information not being drawn attention to? What was that weird bit of information over there that popped up the other day and then it just disappeared? So, what he's talking about here, as far as well, I can tell, it only works short term. get the narrative out there at the beginning and make out that everybody agrees with it, but it doesn't last because the narrative begins to gradually fall apart. But something really interesting what they talk about in here is persuading people that a particular opinion is already popular. Okay, so the narrative comes out. The public haven't really decided what their view on it is yet because they haven't got enough information. But the initial reports will make out that that everybody already agrees. It's not just the news media, it's not just the politicians, the public agree with it as well. And it is very easy. I mean, they are right about this. You can persuade people to adopt certain beliefs by persuading them that, oh, everybody already agrees with this. Yeah, that is true. And so one way you can do that is to have rigged statistics. You can have cherry-picked opinion polls. For example, you could get an opinion polling firm. They could do 5 opinion polls, and maybe only one of them will be made public, and that's the one where the result is what they want it to be. Whereas the other ones, they get buried. I've seen this before. Sometimes a public opinion poll will be made public, and then it rapidly disappears because, oh no, it doesn't fit with the narrative. I've seen that happen before as well. But what I found very, very interesting in this chapter about how this is framed, I'll see if I can find a particular quote of it. Here's an interesting little point here before I go on to that. In terms of politics, some interesting quotes here. Democrats and Republicans, they're talking about a sort of public opinion test that was done here with a load of subjects. Democrats and Republicans often flipped positions depending on what the early voters did, as in what they perceived the early voters to have done. As the researchers put it, chance variation in a small number of early movers can have major effects in tipping large populations and in getting both Republicans and Democrats to embrace a cluster of views that actually have nothing to do with each other. Yeah? These findings help explain how members of both parties flip over short periods of time and also how issues suddenly and surprisingly become polarizing across political lines. Okay, so they are talking here about how public opinion can be shifted in terms of people's voting patterns if you persuade them in the early stages of an issue, if you persuade them, oh, this is what your chosen political party thinks, this is what your contemporary voters of your same political position think. Therefore, and the underlying message of that is, therefore, you should think that way, otherwise you are not what you think you are. And tons of people I've seen this happen with. They will adopt a position because the other position is perceived to be the enemy political party. It's not the enemy political party's position at all. It's actually something that could be taken by either side. But as soon as people get this idea that, oh, people of my political party think this, and people of my enemy political party think that, they will automatically shift their positions in accordance with it in order to maintain their chosen party identity. I think that's what they're talking about there. Small interventions and even coincidences at a key stage can produce large variation in the outcome. And I think it is important to make these things look like coincidences. We can go further. Most of today's political leaders are hard to distinguish from dozens or even hundreds of others whose candidacies badly fizzled. Much the same can be said for professors and for companies and products of all kinds. Social influences matter, and so does luck. So, I mean, that sounds like something that a conspiracy theorist would say, doesn't it? You know, that's kind of like saying people who get good positions in academia, politics, whatever, are not necessarily the skilled people. They're just people who are sort of ushered into those positions by misleading narratives, you know? Okay, so let's go forward. There was something I was looking for that I considered to be quite important. So we've got a nice little piece of distortive language here. Choice architects. Basically, these are people who manipulate public opinion. The term choice architects is contradictory in itself. If you design somebody else's choice for them, then it wasn't their choice. Choice is when you step out the way and you let them decide for themselves. If you go in there and try and manipulate them to have the choice that you want them to have, you are taking away choice. Okay. I mean, you can give information, but at the end of the day, it's up to them. If you consider their choice to be your design, which is what choice architects says, then it's a contradictory term. And they talk about using identity-based cognition. Again, that goes back to the thing of party allegiances. This is one of the reasons why, for a long, long time, I've had no political party allegiance. I don't make videos or articles or anything pushing for any specific political party or against any specific political party, because I don't want to join these, what they call identity-based I don't want to be involved in identity-based cognition. I don't want to have my worldview limited by identifying with a particular group. So I stay as an individual and I keep my voting choices open and I listen to all parties and sides as much as I can. Ah, yeah, here's one. They've got this lovely term here, pluralistic ignorance. All right. Okay, let me just read this in context. For those who want to enlist social influences, an important challenge, as well as a real opportunity, is pluralistic ignorance. That is, ignorance on the part of all or most about what other people think. Now, isn't this interesting? The chapter is called Following the Herd, and the content is all about how people can be manipulated into having a certain position if you persuade them in the early stages of a narrative what the widely accepted position already is. Now, people who don't fall for that, people who wait to hear a narrative in full and get all sides before they make an opinion, in my view, and I'm sure in most of your views, those are the more mature, grounded people, the people who don't just jump on the bandwagon right away. Independent thinking, people who are a bit more cautious, people who like to gather evidence more first. But they refer to that frame of mind as pluralistic ignorance. They think it's ignorant if you don't just automatically follow the herd. That's what it seems to be saying here. Okay, so I'm quoting here. A dramatic example is communism in the former Soviet bloc, which lasted in part because people were unaware of how a large share of the population despised the regime. As people became aware of what others actually thought, they were emboldened to say what they believed and to act accordingly. Now, I do think that is true. Yeah, if you can persuade people that their opinion is an extremely small minority opinion, that hardly anybody else around agrees with you, then people do tend to be quiet. But I find if I go out in the world and I actually talk to people on narrative issues, I take whatever the major news media stories of the day are and I go around to just friends, family, people in the street, people in restaurants, cafes, wherever I happen to be eating, taxi drivers, whoever, and I just ask those people, oh, what do you think of this and that? You know, I'll frequently do that. It's like I'm doing my own little public opinion polling, and I very often find that tons and tons of people who I talk to and question disagree completely with a narrative which, according to the news media, is commonly accepted. So I don't think that people are as herd-based as what they make out. But it seems that what they're trying to do is tell people, they want to persuade people that more people are, I'm not wording this correctly. It seems that part of their tactic, their PR tactic, is to persuade people that everybody else is a follower of the herd. Here's the narrative, and you don't want to be the odd one out because everybody else is following that narrative because everybody else is just basically a herd follower. If you're an independent thinker who takes your time and thinks things out, then you're on your own and nobody's on your side. And that's garbage because, well, as I said, if you go around and question people in real life, the narratives are often very different to what they are in the news media. And this actually makes me wonder whether the writers of this book and people who write similar books and documents and so on, people who basically are supposed experts in manipulating public opinion, it makes me wonder how connected to reality these people are. Do they ever actually go out in public themselves? Just dress like a normal person. Take your fucking suit off. Go out, dress as a normal person, just chat to regular everyday people. Not rich people. Chat to middle class, lower class in their own environments and ask them their opinions on these issues. I think a lot of these people who write these kind of books would find that their own opinions are actually quite widely disagreed with. Okay. But I don't think they're interested in that anyway, because they're not interested in what is really going on. They're interested in how they can make their own opinions more popular. Okay, so interesting quotes here. The nudge, which is the PR term for manipulate, the nudge is emphatically social. It often turns out to be a kind of permission slip. So if you can persuade somebody that a view is already popular, then not only will they believe it, but they will actually speak it to others themselves, thus reinforcing the false consensus. And yeah, that's a key term that I wanted to get in here was, I think this book should be called Manufacturing Consensus based on this chapter. Not Manufacturing Consent, that was the old Chomsky book and film. I haven't read his book, but the Manufacturing Consent film, the documentary, was very, very good. But yeah, manufacturing consensus, making people believe that your propaganda opinion is actually more widely held than it is. All of these Okay, so he's talking about the rise of gay marriage, Me Too and Black Lives Matter. All of these movements were fueled by visible actions, including vigorous social media campaigns that permitted or encouraged people to reveal long-silenced anger and outrage. Some truth to that, yeah? But here's the thing. As this chapter got to the close, what I found was that instead of just admitting that, hey, our strategy is to persuade people of a particular opinion by basically lying to them or cherry-picking information to give to them that gives them the false impression that the view you wanted them to have is already widely held. That's a very manipulative tactic to have, and it seems to me that that's what they're encouraging. And I think a lot of policymakers and corporate bosses and stuff would take that message from there. Okay, yeah, I found the quote part. Some taxpayers are more likely to violate the law because of a misperception, plausibly based on the availability of media or other accounts or of cheaters, that the level of compliance is pretty low. So if people think that compliance with tax is very low, then they are less likely to comply with it themselves. When informed that the actual compliance level is high, they become less likely to cheat. Okay, so persuading people that a particular law is being complied with by virtually everybody, that in itself will make most people comply. So the lie becomes true. Instead of admitting that that is the tactic, they frame it as a sort of position of that the public does already agree with your position that you want to promote. And all you have to do is communicate to the wider public the fact that most people do already privately agree with that opinion. Am I explaining that correctly? And so what they're talking about is what you would term honest propaganda, if you could call it that. That you basically tell people, explain to people, look, everybody else already agrees with this, but they just haven't had the guts to say it yet. But now that you know that everybody else agrees with it, you can say it, right? And that's a very clever way of getting around the idea that you're actually lying to people about what the herd are doing. That's the one thing in this chapter I found absolutely hilarious and very manipulative. And it's a good bit of plausible deniability. So anyway, that's like, that's one chapter in this book, which I'm finding very, very interesting. I'm sure I'll be reading more chapters of that in the coming months. Okay, now onto my worst cinema experiences ever. I wanted to have a nice round number of 10 for this, but actually came up with 12. In number 12, we have the Sylvester Stallone movie Over the Top, which came out in the late 80s. This was basically just a movie about arm wrestling. It was basically Rocky, but done with arm wrestling. And I went to watch it with a friend, and I guess it was technically well made, but it was such a boring subject matter. And, I just found that I couldn't get myself to sort of cheer and feel great about watching two guys just doing that, in a 5-minute arm wrestle near the end of the movie. And you just know what's going to happen. He's going to pull them that way. And then the hero is going to get nearly beaten, and he's going to pull back and beat. I was like, fuck off. This is just crap script writing. Yeah, I thought it was a lame movie, and I would not go and watch that again. Number 11 on my worst cinema experiences is the Spielberg movie War of the Worlds. Now, this movie started off very, very good. It's like the first 20 minutes when the aliens reveal themselves and they come out the ground and stuff. It was like, fucking hell, this is like really good. This is terrifying. That was a really good 20 minutes, and I was like, okay. I think I was watching it with my dad when it came out, and we were like, oh, this is good. This is way better than the old War of the Worlds. And then the rest of the movie was just boring as hell. Hardly anything happened. I can't even remember hardly anything that happened throughout the rest of the movie. But yeah, a great 20-minute opening. Should have just released the first 20 minutes as a short film. That would have been better. Number 10 on my worst cinema experiences is James Cameron's Avatar. Note that we've got some pretty good pedigree directors here. I expected more from James Cameron with this because he's done some of my favourite movies. But I do think he's declined gradually over the years. Terminator and Aliens for me are still his two best movies. The Abyss was decent. Flawed, but had a lot of good stuff in it. Terminator 2 had fantastic action scenes. But some elements that I thought were quite badly scripted. Anyway, so, and then we go from all that, where there's great movies that are well worth going to see, even if they do have flaws, to Avatar. Fucking hell, I went to watch Avatar with my girlfriend at the time. It was like, fucking hell. It's like the first 5-10 minutes is like, okay, I've never watched these new 3D glasses. I don't think I'd ever used them before for a movie. I think they were brought out specifically for that movie. The 3D technology for movies had really advanced. That didn't get me into the film. I think the first 5 minutes, I was like, whoa, okay, this is pretty cool, the 3D. And then that wore off. And then the rest of the movie just bored me to hell. It was full of what they call Easter egg references to Jim Cameron's other movies. Which bores me. I don't like movies that just have lots of Easter egg references, so the audience feels clever by noticing, oh yeah, I recognize that from the movie Aliens, I recognize that from this movie and that movie. No. If you're going to encode hidden stuff in your movies, make it have meaning. Don't just encode references to other movies just for the sake of it. But, you know, Avatar does that. And I thought the story was boring, I thought the characters were boring, and the themes of the movie were boring and didn't work because, you know, it's supposed to be a sort of nature worship movie. You know, technology is bad and nature is good. And yet, virtually all of the nature that we see in the movie is fucking CGI. You know, it's computer generated. I mean, a little while ago, I watched Greystoke, The Legend of Tarzan, the old 1984 classic. I watched that with my daughter, and I was stunned at how great that movie still is. And the nature scenes at the start of that movie actually look like real nature. I don't know exactly how and where they shot them, but they've got real plants in there. And, you know, they've got ape outfits, but they're not CGI apes. They're people in costumes. The costumes are pretty fantastic. And I really related to that movie in terms of its nature versus civilization conflict. Well, Avatar, it just felt fake. You know, the movie is sort of anti-technology, and yet technology is used to generate the actual nature that we see in the movie. And it presents nature as being this wonderful thing that is all beautiful and nice, whereas in reality, nature can be really, really brutal. In some ways, nature is worse than people. Just think of all the horrible diseases and the horrible types of deaths that creatures live experience, and the suffering that goes on in nature. It's not like Earth would be a paradise without humans here. The amount of suffering that nature inflicts upon the species of Earth is way worse than what humans inflict. Didn't do it for me at all. Didn't like the themes, didn't like the story. There's just very little I liked in it. The graphics were like pretty to look at, and that was about it, and that's not good enough. could have just presented me with like a 10-minute short film just showing all those lovely graphics, and that would be it. Number 9 on my list here is The Matrix Reloaded. My God, this was a big disappointment to go and watch. I didn't see the original Matrix movie on the cinema because I didn't really like the look of it when it first came out. But then I got to see it on DVD and I was like, oh, okay, bloody hell, this is interesting stuff. It's quite a good movie. A lot of themes, a lot to think about. And then when I went to, I watched it with an old friend of mine who I'm not friends with anymore. And I watched The Matrix Reloaded and I was bored from start to finish. I can't even tell you what the story was about because I was so bored by it. It was so cliched. There was a handful of half-decent action scenes. The only thing that really stood out to me in the film as memorable was the freeway chase, and that was it. And that probably lasted 5 minutes. Didn't like The Matrix Reloaded. Number 8 is Blade Runner 2049. Those of you who are familiar with my videos, you knew this was going to be on the list. And no, it didn't make it to my number 1 hated spot, but at number 8. The reason it's at number 8 is because there are some small elements of Blade Runner 2049 that I do like, but not much. I would say 90 to 95% of the film I can't stand. Even the fans of the film tend to call it a visual masterpiece. I've heard that term used a lot. And people use the term visual masterpiece when they know that the script is basically crap, the story is crap. But Blade Runner 2049 isn't a visual masterpiece at all. The original Blade Runner was, and that movie used all of the smoke and moving lights and flashing lights and all that kind of stuff. And the original Blade Runner was way more gorgeous looking visually and far more visually interesting. Blade Runner 2049 looks bland as hell. There's just a lot of block boringness in the colour. The colour schemes, you know, there's very little texture and detail. There's hardly anything in there that communicates much about the world. It's a fucking boring film. I'm sorry, folks. I've said it before and I'll say it again. It was one of the worst cinema experiences I ever had. And I couldn't wait to get out of the cinema. In fact, with pretty much all of these movies, I couldn't wait to get out of the cinema. Number 7 is Hannibal, the sequel to Silence of the Lambs. Now, I read the novel of Hannibal before I went to see the movie, and the Hannibal novel was brutal. My God, it was savage and disturbing. And it was very, very interesting. There was a lot of very challenging themes in there. In some ways, it almost came off as a little bit cartoonish, but not nearly as cartoonish as the movie version. The movie version started off, well, it was terrible for the fact that they got rid of Jodie Foster and replaced her with that other actress. I can't remember her name. The actress who replaced Jodie Foster to play Clarice Starling was not suited to the part at all. Instantly at the beginning of the film, I couldn't take to her in the role. I know she's a good actress. I've seen her in other things. She had a good little funny role in The Big Lebowski. She's a good actress, but she was not suited to play Clarice Starling. So instantly the film sets itself up for failure with that. And even Ridley Scott directing couldn't save it. The Venice scenes, which were the scenes that most stuck to what happened in the novel, those were the best parts. And they were the most well-casted parts. And funnily enough, Clarice Starling wasn't really present much in that part of the film. That's part of why it was the best part. A lot of the brutality in the book was either toned down or made cartoonish in the film, and they completely changed the ending of the movie from what was in the novel. The novel did not give a politically correct interpretation of the Clarice Starling character. She ends up having a relationship with Hannibal Lecter, and she gives up her career and goes off with him through an extraordinary set of circumstances. And in the film, they changed it so that she rejects him and he chops his hand off in order. I think he's got his hand. His wrist is handcuffed to her wrist and she's handcuffed so he can't get away. She wants to get him put in prison. And he chops his own hand off so that he can escape instead of chopping her hand off. And I just thought that was such a lame and stupid way to end the story. And yeah, Hannibal was fucking awful. Sorry. Number 6 is Again, you know, like I said, we've got quite a few big name directors on this list here, and I guess with a lot of these films, I probably expected more because of these directors. Number six was Kill Bill Part 1. Tarantino's doing a martial arts movie. Oh, I'm up for this. Great, we know he likes his old classic movies and stuff. I thought the story was terrible and the action scenes didn't do it for me, because if you watch the old Bruce Lee and Jackie Chan stuff, they were good performers. They were good. The actual actors, Jackie Chan and Bruce Lee, would get involved in doing like stunt work type stuff that gave credibility to the character. When you saw Bruce Lee doing those wild kicks and roundhouses and stuff like that, it was him doing it, and you didn't have to cut away to a wide shot where an extra can replace them and stuff like that. You hardly ever had that with Bruce Lee. And same with Jackie Chan. When you saw him doing those crazy stunts, you knew it was him who was doing it. And Kill Bill abandons all of that for a traditional Hollywood thing where the actual star of the movie isn't doing the proper stunts. And a lot of the action is over-edited. Action scenes tend to be better when you have less cuts so that the action speaks for itself. But when you've got the two or three cuts a second, it just becomes an exercise in showing off editing skills rather than a proper action scene. I didn't enjoy Kill Bill at all. Hardly any of the film was memorable to me, and I couldn't wait for it to end, and I couldn't wait to get out the cinema. Number five is The Crow. The early, I think it was early 90s or maybe late 80s, starring Bruce Lee's son, Brandon Lee, and then he died. I don't know what the hell happened there. But The Crow, I think I'd heard the soundtrack before I saw the movie, and I was really into a lot of my heavy metal at the time. And the soundtrack to The Crow was great. It had Nine Inch Nails on there and Pantera and all these other bands, a few bands that I'd never heard of, but their songs were good anyway. Great soundtrack. Little bits of industrial music, lots of heavy metal. Went to see the movie and it was boring and cliched as hell. Sure, it had a nice visual style, but visual style doesn't count for shit if you've got a boring character, a crap story with no credibility and no interesting themes. I thought The Crow was one of the lamest movies I've ever seen. Number four is Alien Resurrection. Oh, God. I mean, I know Alien 3 has its fans, even though most people hate Alien 3. But I've hardly ever heard anybody talk about Alien Resurrection as being a good movie. I can barely remember anything from it. I do remember there was a part at the end of the movie where this really stupid looking monster gets sucked through a hole into the gravity of the void. That was the only thing that stood in my memory. I couldn't wait for the film to end, and I can't remember hardly any of it because it was so boring. Number three is Drive. My God, this was boring. Tons of people talked about this film like it was fantastic. When I saw it on the cinema, I could see all over the place where it had stolen scenes from other movies. It stole scenes from Repo Man, the old Emilio Estevez movie from the 80s. It stole scenes from that. It stole scenes from Goodfellas. It stole scenes from, especially from Walter Hill's The Driver, which I think came out in 1978, just before he did The Warriors. The Driver with Ryan O'Neill from 1978 is fantastic. Great action chase scenes, great performances from the actors all around, and a great story, great style. That's an awesome movie. And Drive tries to imitate The Driver, and it fucking fails miserably. Yeah, I think the first 5-10 minutes of Drive, I was moderately entertained, thinking, oh, this might be good. And then the whole movie just turned out to be one stupid cliche after another. And the character, the lead character, was a moron who made all the wrong decisions, and it's crap. Number two was a James Bond movie, Quantum of Solace. Absolutely the worst Bond movie I've ever seen. In the opening scenes, there was a car chase, and there was so much editing, I couldn't tell what was going on. It was just cut. Here's a wheel going past the camera. Here's some dust flying in your face. And it was just terribly edited action. And the movie had a boring plot. And I think there was one or two moderately interesting scenes in it. And I couldn't wait to get out of the cinema for that one. By the way, most of these movies, I would have left the cinema within half an hour, 40 minutes, something like that. Except usually when I've gone to see these movies, I've gone with a friend or a family member or a girlfriend. And then I'm stuck watching it because they like to see the movie right to the end. And I'm sat there thinking, oh, fucking hell. I don't want to be rude to the person I came here with, but I can't wait to get out of here. Anyway, so number one on my list of my worst cinema experiences is the Bruce Willis movie Armageddon, about a fucking meteor that's going to destroy Earth, and they have to send a load of people, astronauts, to plant a big bomb on this meteor that's going to blow it in two so that each half misses the Earth. And fucking hell. I knew within the first 15 minutes this film was utter trash, but I was watching it with my dad and my girlfriend of the time. They wanted to stay and watch the whole thing, and it just got worse and worse. And as the movie was going through, I was thinking, this can't possibly get any worse. This can't get any more stupid. And it did. It continued to get worse and more stupid throughout the runtime. And when it came out the end, I was like, I came out the cinema and I breathed the fresh air. I felt like I'd been suffocated for two fucking hours. Sorry, you can detect a lot of anger in me here. I wasted, between these 12 movies, I wasted about 24 hours of my life on these crap movies. Now, that's a whole day I can't get back. Never mind the money I spent going to see them, and the torture, the emotional and physical torture of watching these films. So yeah, my worst cinema experiences. There you go. Right, folks, so I've covered about 8 topics in this video, just various stuff taken from my notes. The third part of this series I'm making as a Patreon exclusive video. In other words, you can't watch it unless you sign up to me on Patreon. And I haven't recorded it yet. I'm about to record the rest of it. And that's going to have about 8 subjects covered. And it will probably be over an hour long. It could be 90 minutes long. So at the moment, what I've got planned for part 3 of this series, part 3 on Patreon will include my best cinema experiences, which is a list of about 50 movies. And why I loved and seeing them so much on the cinema. It's not necessarily my favourite movies, it's just the best cinema experiences I had. There will be a section on Stanley Kubrick's film encoding technique in relation to the law, the legalities of his film encoding, interesting subject. There'll be a section on humour for mental health. There will be an update on my coverage of the Johnny Depp and Amber Heard court case. I'll give my assessment of the aftermath of that case. There'll be a section called The Matrix Effect, Why Action Movies Don't Work. And there will be a last section called Truth Beyond Intention. And this will be in relation to movies as well. So all of that is going to be in part 3, and at the time of me uploading this video, part 3 will be available to my Patreon supporters. Follow that link in the video description to get access to it. If you're interested in any merchandise, cups, t-shirts, the links to that are in the video description, and the links are on my website as well. Follow there, you can get the t-shirts, the cups, and various other items. So great to speak to you guys as always. If there's any section of this video that you think would make a really good larger video that you'd like to see an expanded version of in a dedicated video, properly scripted and edited, then just let me know. You know, pick out whichever section of the video you liked and just mention it in the comments section and say, this is the one I'd like to see. Okay, that's it for me from now. There will be more parts to this series, of course. Like I said, part 3 is Patreon only. Part 4 will be available for free here on YouTube, and then probably part 5 will be Patreon only. Okay, so stay free and have a good one. See you guys soon. Bye-bye.